morning. Welcome to Unity of Kanawha Valley on Sunday, September 18th. We begin our service with the ringing of the bell and the lighting of the Christ candle. So we do ring the bell and we light the candle with that truth for just a moment. And then repeat, there is only one presence and one power in the universe and in my life, God the good, omnipotent. Our songs this morning are...
Yes, I understand.
We have Jeff and we have Doug Imbroglio that will do our music this morning. And I'd like to invite you all to stand as we sing Surely the Presence.
Number 251.
happy to see so many people here this morning, old friends and new. And we also welcome those who are here virtually on Zoom or maybe watching later on YouTube. Thank you for sharing your time and energy with us today. Sky, do you want to attempt to introduce?
No, after last week's fiasco, I will not attempt it. Phil Herbden is here for the baptism of his daughter, Violet Marie. And Phil, would you introduce your friends and family and godparents?
I can. So we're going to start with my neighbors out in Hurricane. This is Bruce and Jana, and they've been friends since I moved here to West Virginia, and their daughters, Isabella and Olivia. And then this is my brother, Chris, who came in with Ben to help me finish my move to West Virginia and be here for 5 days.
And Phyllis lives in St. Petersburg, for those Floridaites who are here with us. Thanks, Phil.
And Mark came in, Mark and his family came in from New York as well.
Oh, fantastic. She's ready. And Heather, would you... Heather, would you introduce Burks and Angie, please?
Yes, this is my brother, Burks Hancher, and my very dear friend, Agnes Reed.
Agnes.
And my name's Heather.
Welcome. Mary Louise, would you introduce your friends?
Sure. I have a whole crew here for my birthday. It's today.
She's going to get it first.
As most of you know, we have been changing the nursery into a prayer room. Since we also have the Sunday school room, we didn't really see the need for both rooms. And we have been, right now it's very functional and we love it, but we're always on the lookout for things to make it more inviting. And I was on Facebook and saw that our beautiful Elizabeth, who has been with Unity of Kanawha Valley since she was 2, she now lives in Louisville, so she doesn't come very often, but she has a business called EJ Creations, and she creates these beautiful wall hangings.
Yay.
So the prayer chaplains got together and commissioned Elizabeth to do this piece for us, and she brought it to us this morning, and we are so thrilled. So we are thrilled to have Elizabeth with us. We are thrilled that her artwork is going to live in the prayer room. And Beth Laughlin has volunteered her husband to hang it for us. So as soon as that gets done, we do invite everyone to come back and have a look, and we're just so thrilled to have Elizabeth with us today. Is there anything you want to say?
No, I just thank you guys so much for, thank you, Janet, for reaching out to me, because I've never loved a piece as much as this one, and knowing where it's going to be hung, and, in this, because this space does feel like my home. You know, and so I really love it. So thank you, guys.
Thank you, Elizabeth. So with other announcements, we are collecting luggage and backpacks for the Davis Children's Center. If you will get those items here, Dewey Lester will get them to the shelter. The Sojourner Shelter is collecting cereals and non-perishable snacks this month. If you wish to support Sojourners, there's a basket at the end of the stairways down in the activity room, and we fill that up, and Pam makes sure they get to Sojourners. We are a tithing church, and this month our tithe goes to Unity Worldwide Ministries. They are the publishers of the Daily Word that we read here every Sunday, as well as
these booklets that help us on our spiritual journey. The current one is in the flow of healing, and it looks like we have one left of the five principles. So if you want to know more about the five principles of unity, the foundation of unity, this is a wonderful, wonderful little booklet here. And so those are available on both tables. You can just pick one up as you leave. And let's see here. We have more t-shirts and tote bags. They're on the table in the lending library, so you can check those out. The book study group will continue at 7 o'clock on Zoom. And that Zoom room is the same as our phone number. So at 7 o'clock on Thursday, just log into Zoom, type in our phone number. And if they ask for a password, type in 1111. So we make it easy for you. I believe they're discussing the poems of
Cahill Gibran.
Yeah. So that's what they'll be discussing this week. Next Saturday, this coming Saturday at noon, there's a grand opening for the Alea Ashad Center for Nursing Entrepreneurship. There are flyers up here about that. Alea was very close to the heart of the people of Unity of Kanawha Valley. And so to honor her, I understand even some of her children will be there. So this would be a great way to honor her memory. The Unravel group will meet on the 28th. That's not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday at 5:15. If you wish to participate in that, just let Barbie know and then show up. Oh, Barbie wants to talk.
No, I just
Oh, this is Barbie, in case you didn't know who Barbie was. Okay. Okay. And if you have signed up, please remember to show up at Kanawha State Forest between 8 and 9 this coming Saturday for the walk for... Oh, and make sure and wear your Unity t-shirt, because this is an effort to show the community who Unity of Kanawha Valley is. Okay, I think that's all the announcements I have, so I will turn it over to Sky.
I really did. It was just something light, simple, you know.
It is great to have kids in the room with us, and they can be as loud as they want. So parents, don't get nervous. You don't have to shush them. You don't have to worry. They're welcome here. We're glad. Thank you, Violet. Yes, thank you. Good morning. Welcome. Namaste. Bienvenido. Shalom. Assalamu alaikum. And aloha. The light in me greets the light in you. My name is Sky Kirshner. I want to welcome you to Unity of Kanawha Valley live. Yay! And online. Thank you for being with us from wherever you are. There will be a discussion group immediately after the service in the Sunday school room. And everything else has been announced. The mission of Unity of Kanawha. Oh, there are membership forms. Has that been announced? There are membership forms on the pew. We have an annual membership here, so if you want to subscribe to your membership, now's the time to do it. And it's very easy. There's nothing to renounce. There's nothing to say you believe. It lets us know what your current address is, what your phone number and email is, and that you have a stake in the future of Unity of Kanawha Valley. So feel free to fill that out if you're already a member. And even if you're not a member, the membership form is like 3 inches longer. So with a couple other questions, just so we can get to know you a little bit more. The mission of Unity of Kanawha Valley is to help create and support a welcoming community of love, acceptance, and spiritual exploration. If you are here or watching us for the first time, I want to say welcome to you. Here at Unity, we celebrate our being alive together. Each of us is worthy of dignity and respect with no exceptions. We affirm our diversity. We recognize that each of us is on our own unique journey, and that we are here to support each other in our uniqueness. It's my hope that you will know that you are welcome here just as you are, that you're free to be yourself and believe whatever you would like to believe, and you're invited to explore some ideas that might be useful in your life. Today, I will be reflecting on life, baptism, and the early church. Whew. If you want to know more about Unity, check us out online. If you've been attending and you'd like to consider becoming a friend or member, well, you've got the forms right in front of you. Prayer, or give me a call and we can have lunch and talk about it. Prayer is a central part of what we're about here today, so let's do that right now. Would you soften your gaze? Close your eyes if you feel comfortable. Let a smile come to your face and just notice how that feels to be smiling as you attend to your inner self. And would you say silently to yourself, I discover a special beauty everywhere and in everyone. I discover a special beauty everywhere and in everyone. And if you would, imagine you are holding someone you love. It doesn't matter if you've been separated by time, by distance, by life, or by death. Imagine that you are standing or sitting in front of them. Look them in the eye. Let gratitude for them fill your heart. And would you say to them, thank you for being here with me today. Thank you for being here with me today. And if you would, give yourself a nice big stretch and a nice big yawn. Turn to somebody next to you and would you say to them, thank you for being with me on this journey. I want to thank each of you for being here with us today. Your being here is a part of the world we are creating together. Every small thing you do today makes a difference in your life and in the life of those around you. I want to thank the universe, God, the source of all life and love, for another day on this amazing journey. I want to thank everyone who's made this service possible. Here we go. For Stephen and our bodacious board of broad-minded buoyancy, brilliance, breathtaking balance, benevolence, and badass blessedness. That includes Barbie, Rich, Laura, David, and Sally. For Pam, who I could not do whatever I do, I couldn't do it without her, our multitasking magician of administrative magic. Let's hear it for Pam, please. For Ron and Jeff and Doug, our guest musician today, our hardworking heroes of heavenly harmony. For Janet, our jubilant general of joie de vivre. That's a new one, right? I got the French in there. That's good. For Ernie Kessel, our heavenly online hostess of the mostess. For Rich and Bobby Lee, our zippy and zany Zoom meisters. I ran out of Z's, I'm sorry. For our amazing prayer chaplains who call each member every month with an affirming, powerful prayer of pervasive presence. Sharon, Janet, Marianne, Laura, Alexa, Sally, and Beth. And for that amazing, does that have a name? That
macrame.
And for Sally, are you doing kids today?
No,
not doing kids today. Great to have you here. Okay. You're the prayer chaplain today for our daily word reader, who I also don't know, Stephen Keith, thank you so much. And our junior bell ringer, who rang our bells today? Tegan. Let's hear it for Tegan. Thank you for ringing our bell today, Tegan. And I want to remind you that God is our source. The pen is in your hand. and a new day is dawning for us all. And so let us enter into a more extended period where we practice the presence of God in this present moment. So you might simply notice the sounds in the room. And the kids are giving us a great opportunity to notice without judgment the sounds in the room. We're just observing. You might notice the quieter sounds in the room, the sound of the air moving, the air conditioning, the sound of people shuffling, getting more comfortable. You might notice the experience of having a body and of being in a body. You might notice the experience of breathing. This circulation of the breath. The giving and the receiving. The taking in of the breath and the letting go. Each thought comes and we let it go. Each breath comes and we let it go. Each sound comes and we let it go. Jesus said, "Seek ye the kingdom." The kingdom is among you. It is in your midst. It is at hand. And it is within. And so we practice this teaching of Jesus as we go within. Wondering, noticing the expansiveness of this kingdom within. And we notice the qualities of our internal world. The quality of abundance and sufficiency. The sense that everything we need is present right here and right now. We notice the quality of relationships, connection, friendship, family, love. And we notice that sometimes repair is needed, apology, repentance, forgiveness, reconciliation. This inner kingdom is the place of healing, the place where every cell in our body knows what it needs to do to bring us to a greater expression of ourselves in this great circle of life. A place of healing and acceptance. And the kingdom within is a place of guidance, a place where we notice both the external world and the internal world. We pay attention to our intuition. We notice that there is a greater wisdom in this world than simply our own personal ideas. And we open ourselves up to this greater wisdom, sometimes without understanding, following its promptings, following its guidance and its leanings. And it's from this place that we reach out to anyone, anywhere, in any need or trouble, those living in fear, those who are running for their lives, those whose lives have been torn apart by violence, those whose lives have been torn apart by addiction, those whose lives have been torn apart by disease, neglect, abuse. We lift up everyone in our mind's eye, especially those in need or trouble. We see you right now surrounded by love. We lift you up. We know that nothing can separate anyone from the love which is God. And that the consciousness and the awareness of God's presence is possible in every circumstance, for every person, with no exceptions. And for this, we are grateful.
The Daily Word for today, Sunday, September 18th, 2022, is thoughtful. And today's affirmation: my kind thoughts and deeds are a blessing. Today, I bring the love and peace of God to all of my encounters by being thoughtful. More than politeness and deeper than kindness, thoughtfulness means I consider the comfort and happiness of others equal to my own. My intention is to let those in my life know what they mean to me. I may reach out to someone who needs an encouraging word, letting them know they have what it takes to succeed. I may surprise someone with a kind act, anticipating a need and taking care of something for them before they have to ask. Each thoughtful word and act lets those in my life know how important they are to me and how worthy they are of my time and attention. And today's scripture from the book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verse 16, do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God.
lo and behold, a godless Appalachian haiku is a song of mine. And it is the perspective of a allegedly godless person having a conversation with God about the idea of God. And during the course of the song, the person recognizes that everywhere he or she looks is this idea of God. If you like this song, you can actually hear it on Spotify in a beautifully engineered version by Bob Webb. Streets like a puff of snow. Lo and behold, a strong wind bending the ginkgo trees like a curling wave in the bright blue sea. Lo and behold, lo and such a fine idea. Lord, how I wish you were. Oh God, please pray for those who don't believe. Lord, how we grieve for top filled with marching pine, evening sun the color of dark red wine. Lo and behold, sparrow chases cowbird away from the nest where sparrows new eggs lay. Such a fine idea. Lord, how we wish you were. Oh God, please pray for those who don't believe. Lord, how we grieve for such a fine idea. Oh Lord, how we wish you were. Oh God, please pray for those who don't believe. Lord, how we grieve for thee. Thank you.
Thanks, Jeff. Let's see if the kids want to come up. Looks like we've got Takeman. You'd like to come up just for a second? I'm looking at the older kids. Taken, come on up. Well, we may as well have everybody come up. Come on up for the baptism. It's everybody's, all the family and godparents and everybody, Mom, Phyllis, come on up. Let's just gather around the this thing here. And Taken, come on over, because I want to explain what this is. So just gather around here. Gene, you want to come with Taken? Taken, who just flopped. It's easy to, yeah, so just gather around the table here. Come on up here. This is a kids' event here. All right, maybe front row. Gene, front row, maybe? Okay, so we're doing a baptism, and... All right, so it's good. It's good. Everything's good. So welcome. It's great to have you guys here from New York and from Florida and from Hurricane. So it's good to have you here. So would you join me in the opening statement, our usual opening statement? There is but one presence and one power in the universe and in my life. God, the good, omnipotent. So we've already welcomed you all, Phil, so thank you for that. How are you doing, Violet? You look a little sleepy. Are you a little sleepy? Well, let's get this thing moving. So baptism, as you all know, is a rite of passage. It is an outward, invisible sign of a blessing that we all share. We all share in the blessing of life. It doesn't matter if you've been baptized or not, you are sharing in the blessing of life. Each of us shares this energy, and we are united in this way, in a special way. In this baptism, we're saying three things. We're welcoming Violet to this earthly experience with us. We're saying in a big way that we love and acknowledge her. And we're committing ourselves by our presence and our intention and our words to her physical, emotional, and spiritual safety and growth. Phil, do you want to say a few words about your hopes and intentions for Violet and her life? And you could say them into that.
Well, thank you very much. My hope is that I can be a leader of faith. I hope that she is raised as a faithful person, and my intention is to be her spiritual leader as she grows up, and that she is honored by my love and honors others with her love.
That's beautiful. Thank you so much. Would you guys like to say something as well?
Yes, as the Godfather and Godmother, our job is that if anything were to happen to Violet's parents, that we would ensure that she would be raised in a very spiritual manner and have God as number one.
Beautiful. Anything else to add?
No.
Okay. And would you like to do the reading? We've got a reading from Cahil Gibran on children.
Your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And though they are with you, yet they belong not to you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts, for they have their own thoughts. You may house their bodies, but not their souls, for their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. You may strive to be like them, but seek not to make them like you, for life goes not backward, nor tarries with yesterday. You are the bows from which your children are living arrows. Living arrows are sent forth. The archer sees the mark upon the path of the infinite, and he bends you with his might that his arrows may go swift and far. Let your bending in the archer's hand be for gladness, for even as he loves the arrow that flies, so he loves also the bow that is stable.
Thank you very much. And we have in the hymnal, it might be in the back, number 13, it's page 529. We have a little thing, and there are those handouts there if you would like to join us. Is that there, 529? Page 529, not hymn number 529. It's number 13. Sharon has found it, so it's in there. It's in the very, very back. It's called The Blessing for a Child. All right. Blessed be this child of God whose very beginning is as our own. Blessed be this child of love who reflects the love of God. Blessed be this child of life whose very being stems from the action of God. Blessed be this child of wisdom, whose ever-expanding mind will touch the font of knowing. Blessed be this child of eternity, who has no alpha and no omega. Thank you, Mother, Father, God, for another expression of your eternal loving presence. All right. This is a very curious young lady we have here, isn't it? She is into, and let's hear it for these parents who are trying to do their best to corral. So do you want to come over here and see what we've got going on? Would you like to come over here? Yeah, come on over here. Yeah, come on over, Libby. A lot of talk, not much action. That's what I'm getting here from Libby. Okay, Libby, here we've got water. Do you see the water? Yeah, a big hug. That's good. Okay, you stay close to your mom. So here we've got water, and we're going to pour that water out. And let's get that for our Zoomers. So we've got water here, which is a main symbol of baptism. And we also have the rose petals, and we're going to be using those in a second. So the symbol of water, creation, flood, Egypt, Jesus, womb and birth, survival, and the fountain within. We are all drops of water from the same ocean of God. We are all rivers flowing towards the same ocean. Phil, how do you name this child?
I name this child Violet Marie Herndon.
All right, if you want to bring her over, if you want to give her to the grandparents, you can do that as well. Yeah, let's go over here. All right, Violet Marie Herndon, I baptize you in the name of the Creator, the Redeemer, and thank you, the Sustainer. Amen. Violet Marie, you have Violet Marie, you have within you all the love, imagination.
It's and, the air she's moving.
And it's okay. And spiritual power you will ever need. because the Spirit of God is in you and remains in you at all times and in all places and in all circumstances. And let me move this out of the way. So if we've got a way to do it, let's see how to, if you want to hold her again, and if everybody wants to, this is the fun part. Everybody gets some rose petals. So bring her over here. So grab some rose petals, please, from the, do you want to join in taking? We're going to throw these at, well, we're going to sprinkle them. All right. So you might have to get up high here, so we're just going to sprinkle these on top of Violet. So are you ready, Violet? Here it comes. Oh, yeah. Violet Marie Herndon, I welcome you in the name of God. May your life be full and long. May you know the fullness of all that life and love has to offer. Members of the family of God, I commend this person, Violet Marie Herndon. Do all in your power to increase her trust in the world, confirm her hope, and may she always know that she is perfect in love. And can we say a big amen? Amen. Yeah, get all those rose petals. Okay. Welcome. So that's closes out the baptism part. Feel free to take as many of those as you want. Good job, Violet. And thank you all so much for coming for this beautiful service. All right, let's hear it again for our family. Thank you. Well, I hope we got a close-up of that one, Bobby Lee. Well, and you know what? Mary Louise? Oh, we can't go too far. Okay. I'm going to have to clean these up afterwards, but let's hear it from Mary Louise! Well, an elderly couple had dinner at another couple's house, and after eating, the wives left the table and they went to the kitchen. It was a heterosexual couple. The two gentlemen were talking, and one said, you know, last night we went out to a new restaurant, and it was really great, and I think we ought to go out there all together. And the other man said, oh, that sounds wonderful. What's the name of the restaurant? Well, the first man thought and thought and finally said, oh, what's the name of that flower? That flower that you give to someone you love, you know, the one that's red and has thorns. And his friend said, do you mean a rose? And the man replied, yeah, that's the one. And then he turned to the kitchen and he yelled, hey, Rose, what's the name of that restaurant we went to last night? Thank you, Jeff. Put your hand on your heart, please, and repeat after me. This is my heart. Through it, I am connected to my neighbor, to my source, and to myself. I'm learning to trust it in all things. And I am grateful. Well, baptism is a sign of God's love. It's a reminder that you carry God's Spirit in you. Baptism does not put God's Spirit in you. God's Spirit is in you as a fact of your existence. You're welcome to think of the activity of the water however you like. I do want to introduce you to the idea of the unity way that we think about baptism, and this is common to all non-dualistic thinkers across all religious traditions. We tend to believe that nothing can separate us from the love of God. There is no sin in that sense to be washed away in baptism, because You're fine before baptism, and you're just as fine after baptism. You cannot be separated from God or from the love that is God at any point in your life. Before baptism, after baptism, still love is love is love. Whether you're baptized or not, regardless of what you believe, regardless of how you're acting or what's been to you, God is within you, just like gravity is working on you at all times. Events like baptism that we just participated in, or birthdays, are considered to be rites of passage. We sing on somebody's birthday. We have a baptism when someone is born or when they're ready to decide that they want to get baptized for whatever reasons. This is, of course, a reenactment of Jesus' baptism by the John the Baptist in the River Jordan, just like communion is a reenactment of Jesus' Last Supper. It became a rite of passage for the Christian community because, well, frankly, it was easier than circumcision. Because we're not doing that once we have a say in it, right? Or at least that's the rite of passage for males in the Jewish community. But it does add confusion when it is seen as making someone more special or more loved by God. The unity understanding of the good news as Jesus taught it was that everyone everywhere is loved equally by God, regardless of what you believe. There are no exceptions to this. When Jesus is alive, he sends his disciples out two by two to do what? To preach the good news. What is the good news that he's sending them out to preach? It's very simple. You are loved no matter what. What Jesus discovered in himself is that same thing that we believe that he taught, that you have God's love, you have God's spirit within you. So what we think, what the Unity folks think, and again, you're welcome to think of this however you want, what we, the Unity folks think, we're practicing with baptism, is an awareness of the Spirit that's already within you, a conscious expression of God's Spirit out into the world in our thoughts, words, and deeds. That's why we get together, to remember that we are expressions of God and to let that expression come more fully. When we think about the first gatherings of early Christians, they weren't called Christians, by the way, they were called followers of the way. These folks owned no property. If they had property, they held it in common. You remember when the rich young ruler comes to Jesus and he says, "What do I have to do?" And Jesus, you know, he says, "I've done all that." And then Jesus says, "Give away everything you have and follow me." And this was an expectation of the early church, that you would be generous and you would give away everything you had. It was pretty clear from the gospel record that the early followers of Jesus were expecting, after Jesus' death, that he would be returning very soon. So you weren't going to need your property because Jesus was coming back right away, as in before the last disciple died. So there was no need for property or a building or things like membership, because they were expecting that these things weren't needed. Just as a little aside, when I was in college, I was a member of a very charismatic prayer group. And this charismatic prayer group met every day at lunchtime to pray. And these folks were praying in tongues, and they were having all sorts of experiences like that. And this Holy Spirit was talking to them. And the Holy Spirit told the leader of the group that Jesus was coming back, and it happened to be during exam week. my friends in the group decided that studying for the exams, in fact, going to take their exams, was irrelevant. And so they stayed in prayer the entire time during exam week. And when the report cards came out, I have heard that the dean got a number of angry phone calls from the parents who said, "What the heck is going on at this college?" They were experiencing, they were practicing a practice that the early Christians believed, that Jesus was coming back immediately, so you didn't need rites of passage or even membership. This is why the Apostle Paul recommends that it's better to stay single than to get married and have children, right? Not because celibacy is any great thing, but because this thing's about to happen. You don't want to be encumbered, or I don't know what his thinking was, but you know, the end times were coming. They might be difficult. It's better to just go it alone. Now, two things happened that made church membership the norm. The first one was that Jesus didn't come back as expected in clouds of glory before the first generation of followers had died off. And when that happened, when the first generation started dying off, people got really confused and they had to do what we call reinterpret Jesus' message to figure out, well, if he didn't mean that, then what did he mean? And that's when we get all sorts of different ideas of what it means that Jesus is coming back. Here at Unity, we interpret this, the idea of Jesus returning, as an everyday event in our lives. In the power of the present moment, the Spirit of God returns or is present at all times. Some of the Unity writers say that now is the day of judgment. There's not a day of judgment in the future. The day of judgment is now, when you get to decide how you're going to turn your consciousness. Nobody got hurt? Okay, good. The other thing that happened to the movement that started with Jesus, which began when the members came together, it was pretty secret, right? Not only did they not have property, but they were being persecuted. So when they would gather, it was, you know, in hidden places like catacombs or people's homes. There weren't big signs. They weren't putting it out on the internet because they didn't want to be chased down and arrested. Six generations after Jesus, an event happened that changed Christianity, what we now know as Christianity forever. And that is that the Holy Roman Emperor, Constantine, decided to become Christian. And when he became Christian, all of a sudden Christianity becomes completely accepted all across the empire. And now it's a good thing to be Christian, and now you don't have to hide anymore. In fact, if you want to be in good with the emperor, you become Christian just to be part of the in group. Church membership then, and by the way, property started to happen. Right, because now you can own property, and now what are we going to do? And so now we own property, and now we're building buildings, and now we're creating artwork, and all of a sudden, the Vatican has these huge troves of artwork and wealth, all because in 300, Christianity became the national religion. Church membership, starting with baptism, became a function of the bureaucracy of the church. I was trying to decide what to wear today, and I was thinking, is Phil going to wear a suit? He might wear a suit. Maybe I ought to wear a tie. And several people said, I don't know if I've ever seen you in a tie, Scott. Why am I wearing a tie? Because I'm an agent of the bureaucracy of the church. This is a sign of my bureaucracy. And just to make it clear, How do I know this? Because I am authorized to baptize, right? Because the bureaucracy now says, oh, you can't just have anybody baptize people. You have to have certain people who now have this power or whatever. John the Baptist, he's not part of the bureaucracy. He's on the run, right? The bureaucracy is chasing him down, right? When Jesus gets baptized, this is an iconic, this is an illegal act, basically. When they finally catch John the Baptist, what do? They behead him. Right? But now I wear a tie to baptize because I am part of the bureau. Yeah, right. Yeah. Because I am part. You wonder why it's around the neck. Yeah.
I have no intentions of having
you beheaded. I appreciate that, Phil. And I appreciate that I have a tie. Yeah, but okay. Oh, everybody's gonna join. Okay, feel free to pile in on this one. So I just want to remind everyone that back when Jesus was alive, there was no such thing as in and out. There was no such thing as membership in Jesus' eyes. Everyone was welcome at the table. Tax collectors, prostitutes, sinners, lepers, people that were unclean, even Judas Iscariot is welcome at the table. Why? Because God's love, the spirit of love, is in every person with no exceptions. And that's what we're celebrating today. We're celebrating a new person. We're welcoming Violet Marie into the journey of life. We're celebrating Violet as part of the human family. And by extension, I'd like to welcome and remind and honor and celebrate all of us as members of the human family. So I want to say welcome, we love you, we're here for you, and we're here for each other. May you know that the road rises up to meet you. May you know that the wind is always at your back. May you feel the sun shining warmly upon your face. May you sense that the rains are falling soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may you know that God holds you in the palm of God's hand. Amen. Sally.
Looks like we had a wedding here. All right. Our offering blessing. Divine love moving in and through me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. I give in love, I trust God, and I am grateful.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
is how to shoot at someone who outdrew you. But it's not a cry you hear tonight, not someone who has seen the light. It's a cold and it's a lonely hallelujah. It wasn't much. I tried to feel cause I couldn't touch. I told the truth, I didn't come to fool ya. Even though it all went wrong, I'll stand before the Lord of song with nothing on my lips but hallelujah.
Thank you guys, that was beautiful. Thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that you give to Unity and all the people that are here today for such a wonderful occasion in baptizing a young child who will grow to be a young woman, a mother, and a grandmother someday. And she will be blessed with the love of God in her. Thank you for all the people here that have given to this wonderful church. And thank you for helping us do our job in this community to help others and to give back to those that are in need. We appreciate your kindness and we welcome you back anytime you'd like to come. Amen.
Let's make a circle as we're able for our peace song. And we're going to sing Happy Birthday to Mary Louise. Are there any other birthdays? Charlie? Do I? Thursday. And Mary Louise, anybody else have a birthday? Okay, let's sing.